Talk about a couple of things. So I'll quickly introduce who I am, what we're doing, and the things that we're looking at. Depending on which jokes of mine that you laugh at, I'll elaborate a little bit, so I might go through all of it very quickly, but let me start by telling you who I am. I ask myself every day. This is the first thing that actually got me into all of it. When I was fairly young, I think 12 or 13, I started to develop. I was a coder, and we started a group called F4CG, which stands for Fantastic Four, for a hacking kind of a group. I convinced the main part of my youth to tell my father that it wasn't illegal, and he still wasn't completely convinced, but since afterwards I became CEO of Skynet, it must have been. So actually what I've been doing in my life is kind of divided into two things.
I went to work at Fnac in Paris. Was still in love with the internet, so I led their internet stuff. I became one of the directors at Skynet, and I was fairly young. I was a CEO, so I think I was just 29. Skynet grew to be a fairly large company. I think we had about 1 million customers on DSL and digital media. We launched Belcom TV from that entity, and then I wanted to do something international, so I joined the SBS group. So SBS is the European holding group above, for example, VFTV and VTV and stuff like that here in Flanders. But in total, I think we had 30 television channels and 150 radios and some other stuff. And I was in charge for their innovation new media strategy for the 13 countries. And then we sold the company to ProSieben, which is the second largest media group. So you have RTL and ProSieben. And then probably the most important moment of my life happened, my little boy, like always. So at that time, that's a perfect time to rethink what you actually want to do. And my thought was, I'm not sure if I want to be this kind of executive anymore. So I quit my job, took my boy to California. This was in California, where I still spent quite all of my time. And the main reason was not only the boy, but it was because I felt I wasn't creating anymore. And it's a really weird feeling when you're 35 and you feel that you have an incredible job, but you're not creating anymore. And it fell over me, and I said to my wife, I think I should do it. And she said, you probably already decided. And I said, yes, I'm going to quit tomorrow. But and she quit her job as well. And so we moved to first San Francisco and then Los Angeles, and we started to create. We started to look at things that we wanted to get involved in, stuff that we wanted to support, co-found, invest, a lot of things. There's quite some companies since then that I got involved in. Some you may know, some you might not. Netlog or Two was one of them. Mobile Vikings is kind of a virtual operator from Hasselt. Storify, it's a Twitter-based news feed that just won the South by Southwest Award. They are in San Francisco. In the Pocket is a Ghent-based agency, that stuff. And some more. I didn't put them all here. So the last 3, 4, 5 years I've been creating, and it's really amazing. It's really tough, but it's really amazing if that's what you want to do. Now, at some point, I was more supporting others and investing and things like that. And then I met a partner of mine who you might know, and he's called Maurice Engelen. Maurice is also an artist who is mostly known as Praga Khan, Lords of Acid, and stuff like that. And he told me, Bart, I'm in this TV program. Look it up on what you do if you want to see a TV program. Nowadays, you go to YouTube. I was in LA, and he said, put X Factor and watch, because there's something happening which I would really think that we can make a difference in. And I watched up the video and I saw this.
Ik vind het echt heel erg moeilijk, ook omdat ik omdat ik weet hoe graag dat hij het wilde, maar ik ga toch kiezen voor Karim.
We hebben al 1 stem voor Karim, 1 stem voor Robban. Maurice, ik weet dat dit heel moeilijk is, want dit zijn jouw kandidaten en jij moet nu beslissen wie volgende week terug mag keren naar X-Factor.
Het zijn niet alleen mijn kandidaten, het zijn met name mijn kinderen geworden. We hebben 2 maanden echt dag en nacht samengeleefd, honderden keren getelefoneerd. Ik ben er ook 1000% zeker van dat we meer samengewerkt hebben dan Chris en Dom met haar kandidaten. Daar ben ik 100% van overtuigd. En je mag van mij heel veel vragen, maar dat kan ik niet. Ik stap het hier af. Ik doe daar niet aan mee.
Maurice.
Ik kan geen beslissing nemen. Ik zet me in de zaal en ik doe niet mee aan deze toestand. Zeker niet omdat ik met zulke twee fantastische kandidaten hier moet staan. Wow.
Dat was live TV.
Maurice. Ik heb hier niets anders op te zeggen dan...
He was not invited to jury the next year anymore, but... sorry? Yeah. I think it was 3 years ago, approximately. So then we decided, okay, let's... he said, okay, why was he so angry? It's not only because he had to choose, but also because all of those young talents didn't get signed or released anymore by record labels. And the reason is that a record label is kind of similar to an investment bank. They invest in 10 companies, 9 fail, 1 wins, and the profit of 1 compensates all the others. The only problem with record labels is that where the profit came from, which is music, disappeared in about 10 years. Music sales is very low at this moment. You also have the fact that the psychological barrier to sell music is 10 euro. It used to be a lot more, but Spotify is 10 euro, iTunes is 10 euro, so everything above 10 euro, if you can succeed in selling anything, and that's a lot less than they used to have. So we said, okay, let's try to combine one of the trends, which is social media, let's combine it with a new way of funding, which is crowdfunding, where fans invest into the artist, and let's also try to guide the artist. Let's not just raise money, but let's create a record label around it and a publisher and some other things. I often tell people it's kind of a record label, a crowdfunder, and Moneyball. I don't know if you've seen the movie. So Moneyball is Brad Pitt, who is the coach of a baseball team. And instead of selecting all his talents based on scouting and talking, he analyzes the numbers. So it's kind of a data-based analytics, which is a hot term nowadays. And that's what we do. So we build an internal platform, and we can detect, based on locations, the evolution of how bands are evolving on Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. That's a tree that we're currently measuring, and it gives us an indication of bands that are doing well and that are engaging. And we look at the progress, because it's just as important to have to grow from 100 to 130 fans than from 100 to 130,000. So it's we measure that, and then we, of course, meet the band, and we look at them, we crowdfund them, and we started this exactly 2 years ago. So we launched it 2 years ago. It went fairly well. We had quite some good press, nationally and internationally. We won some awards and got some nominations for stuff in France and UK. And in LA, we won an award for something. So it was a good start. So we're 2 years later. What's probably more interesting is how the artists are doing. The very first one that we launched, it's Eurovision Time. It's becoming my specialty now. So Tom Dice, who grew thanks to Eurovision, who actually didn't have a record label until we picked him up. And then now, since last week, he has 1 gold record with me and my guitar, 1 platinum, 1 gold album with Teardrops, 1 gold single with Il Nouveau, the duet, and since last week, Sunlight is a duet with DJ Antoine, something completely different. But, you know, from 2 years ago, having nothing to where he is today, it's quite amazing. We have other bands like Vienna, Mastercap, Iris. That's the young girl who's going to Eurovision tonight, half final. It's also one other label. In total, we have now, I think we're reaching 40 artists in the first 2 years. And the great thing about it is that we're focusing on young talent. There was a pretty cool article in the newspaper last week where they calculated that Sonic Angel, in its second year of existence, released as much new talent as all the labels together. So that's I think, a good achievement. Now, what can we learn after 2 years? One of the good things is, if I take Flanders specifically, we tried to crowdfund 20 artists and 19 made it. So 95%, which is, I could live with that at school, didn't reach it a lot. And I have a mixed feeling about the number because I think it's much too high. So I would have preferred to have done not 19 on 20, but 65 on 80. We have to do a lot more. One of the interesting numbers as well is that the average amount per person that invests into an artist is 68.3. After 2 years, I have exact numbers. And that's quite high. I told you that getting 10 euro is quite an effort. Here we see that the average investment is nearly 70 euro. And the main reason is that music is not anymore seen as something that you want to have because Spotify or other platforms, they give you access, but it's something around which you build an experience. That's why people still pay quite a lot of money or go to festival. That's why they want to get involved. And here it's even a step further. You're an investor in an artist or in a production. It goes even a step further. You're part of the recording. What we also saw is that initially it took about 4 months to get your budget around, and the budgets usually here in Flanders are between 15 and 50,000. So that's kind of the average amount that we're collecting, and it's now down to 6 weeks. So it takes a month and a half, and you always see kind of a curve. In the beginning, it grows very quickly, and that's the friends and the family and the aunts and everybody's contributing. Then it slows a little, and then we add a lot. You see that one-third is kind of the friends and the family, one-third is people that invest in our platform anyway and that like to do it, and one-third is new people that you find. And it goes, the first 30% goes really quickly, then you work to your 60, and then till the end, everybody wants to be part of it. The crucial part in getting your funding, if I look at all the things that we're doing, is a story that you tell. And one YouTube video of 2 minutes can do it all. It's about, do people believe you? Are you authentic? Are you honest? If Tom Dice would ask 350,000 euro for an album, we would raise zero because it wouldn't be credible. And so there's not one amount. We had one album recorded for 7,000 euro. They made a video on their own and some other stuff around it. But tell the story. What are you going to do? Why do you want to achieve it? And how you want to get there? And that's going to get spread. That's going to get people to believe in you and going to get people to back you. In total, we have now 7,000 bands that applied to our platform. So quite some bands are interested in some good hits. We have now nearly 1,000 concerts that we booked. So that's going fairly okay, or really good. Then we apply the same principle to film. When we launched Sonic Angel, very quickly from young filmmakers, we had the question, okay, I have kind of similar... amounts that I'm looking for. So we started the end of the year with kind of an audition platform for film. And yesterday, the first film got crowdfunded. So we launched a platform, I think, 6 weeks ago. And the first one, she's going to have a ball tomorrow, this Leni Heuge, because her previous film is nominated for the Cannes Film Festival. So there's a short film Cannes Festival. And she's now in Cannes for that. And then I called her this afternoon to tell that her next movie is funded. And so people are really connecting to her. So it's a picture of 10 minutes ago, 101% just this afternoon, but you can keep on funding it. We're also going to apply the same things to applications and others. And I'm going to show you a couple of examples. What we're doing is going fine, but there's other platforms that are doing amazing stuff as well. And it can go really small. And I took this example, I think it's from the Indiegogo platform, not sure anymore. They wanted to raise nearly $400, that 15 people backing it, and it's kind of an educational game. It can start as low as that, and they pre-sell the license of a game. But they collected it. You can go a little bit higher, 20,000, real-time collaborative game making, interesting space, got it in a couple of days. This is already a bigger one. This is an adventure game where it's a fairly known guy, but he raised, in 3 months' time, 3.3 million. So that's quite a big budget. And to tell you, the story of how we told it went pretty viral on the web, and that convinced people. I'll show, I think I have the video here. Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, sorry, I didn't see you there. You caught me indulging in one of my many impressive hobbies. I'm Tim Schafer, and I'm a man of many passions. Drumming, skydiving, like charity or something. But one of the things I'm most passionate about is making games. And one of my favorite types of games to make is adventure games. But these days, it seems like adventure games are almost a bit of a lost art form. They exist in our dreams and our memories and in Germany. People come up to me all the time, and they say,
you should make a point-and-click graphic adventure.
You know, I would, except...
Adventure games are not dead!
Okay, I'm on your side, but if I were to go to a publisher right now and pitch an adventure game, they'd laugh in my face.
But I have money, and I'd buy a copy.
Well, that's nice, but unfortunately, it's not enough money to make a game.
But there's a ton of people out there that are just like me. They'd buy one, too.
I wonder if that's true.
Dude, it's totally true. There's so many people
talking to you. What if there are a lot of adventure game fans out there who want an adventure game? I wonder if there's some way that I could talk to them directly. Cut out publishers altogether. And that's when it occurred to me. Kickstarter. We can use Kickstarter to make a fan-funded old-school adventure game.
Goes on like that. He tells what he needed for what he's going to do. So you see that the amount that he, what they call pledge, is nearly 3 million euro. What's also is very important is this number. Because crowdfunding is not only about finding money or about collecting funds. It's also about pre-building your fan base. And you see that this guy, before his game is done, he has 87,000 fans. When he does the social media campaign, he posts it out, and you see that it's spread all over the place. And he's pre-building his, instead of the usual way of doing it, where you loan money or people invest, and then you create something, and then you start marketing and try to convince people. Here, you involve and you start the dialogue with fans in advance. And even before starting, he's going to be at 100,000 people, and he's going to keep on growing, and people are going to see this game as part of their game. They're going to be so involved that it's going to be result into a massive game. And that's a second interesting element about crowdfunding. It's not only about the money, it's about pre-building your fan base. Now, something happened that changed the crowdfunding landscape a little. This Obama and Jobs, it's a big legacy name, but the Jobs Act actually stands for Jumpstart Our Business Startups. Until this moment, you could only do crowdfunding and give some profit share or other goods in advance, but you cannot actually sell real shares. So to sell real shares, stock, you have to have a prospectus, and you in the US, it's the SEC, that's the regulator, who says, okay, you have to do this and that, and for the money that you're going to raise, it's going to cost you as much. Now, there's been a new law that is passed that allows to sell real shares in your company up to $1 million. And that's a pretty big game changer, because for most startups, that's kind of the capital that, or the maximum of capital that they're needing. And so this is completely changing how venture capital is looking at startups. So it's an incredible moment for everybody who wants to raise funds or collect something or start it. In a couple of months, you'll be able to tell a story, convince people, and raise money without knowing the big institutional people or the banks, who are a little bit more reluctant now on giving loans. So this is changing quite the environment a lot. Now, why? I believe a lot in the cause of doing it for startups, because, first of all, there's a new generation of startups. If I look at the Belgian scene alone, it's incredible what's happening. We had a period where we didn't have a lot of starters, and more the belief is there from a lot of people that the envy, the hoisting to be a starter again. It's not only the young 20 or 23-year-olds or the dropouts who want to be a dropout or not. Doesn't really matter. Everybody has to do what everybody has to do. But you have the young people who want to do a startup, but you also have the 40-year-old or the 35s who said, well, I had one career. I'm done with that. I'm going to do something else. I'm going to create again. And I see another generation of people. It's the 50-plus, the 55-year-olds who say, okay, now that I know that I'm not going on a pension on 53 like it used to be, but at 75, well, I might as well do something that I really enjoy. And very often they have the energy, maybe not to be a developer 16 hours a day, but there's so much knowledge and guidance that they can give to startups that I see a lot of that happening at this moment. A young guy who's being guided and helped by other people and using new kind of systems to find their funding. So that's one big element. There is a new generation of starters, and there is also a big belief that the normal industrial companies are going to be already happy when they keep the current jobs. You know, it's not about this big entity creates new jobs. It's about, okay, we only lose this amount of them. And I believe a lot in the concept of what they call micro multinationals, where you have companies that are working like film crews. You know, you work together 2-3 years and then everybody goes another way. I see a lot of companies being growing and like that. Financial crisis, of course, and pre-building the fan base. Now, there's always a big topic about who wants to be an entrepreneur. Who is an entrepreneur actually here in the audience? Cool. Who wants to be an entrepreneur? That's even cooler. But that's the question. When I grow up, I want to be an entrepreneur. And what does it mean? What does it mean? And you know these pictures. What my friends think that I do, what my mom thinks I do, society thinks I do, what the government thinks I'm good for, what I think I'm do, and what I actually really do. And very often people look at it like this. That's the story of startups. LinkedIn skyrockets, Facebook is 100 billion, Groupon goes there, OMG Pop is bought for 200 million, True Ventures invest in a 90-year-old. Those are the success stories. And I ask a lot of people, and especially guys, what is the true reason why they want to be an entrepreneur? I found this picture because Richard Branson is often kind of the icon of being an entrepreneur, and it's a real picture. But I met a guy last week, or I spoke to him on a or a couple of weeks ago, and something that really struck me when talking to him, and an example that he always takes is this. I don't know if anybody knows Pandora. Pandora is a music streaming service in the US. It's doing really well. They went to the stock market. It's worth $1.5 billion. And this guy is telling a story that it wasn't that easy, because in order to find some financing for his Pandora, he had 300 rejections. 300 venture capitalists told this guy, I don't think this music thing of yours is going to work. So conviction and being really convinced that you want to do it, that's one of the important elements. And that's not the only story. You probably know Starbucks, the coffee to walk around in. He also told a story that he had 120 rejections from VCs. 120 people told a guy, are you crazy? You think people are going to pay extra to have a plastic cup which is too hot to walk around in the street? Mark Andreessen, kind of the guy who's doing in Silicon Valley, who's a little bit the godfather of entrepreneurship, wrote something down which I think summarizes it a lot. Realize that a startup puts you at an emotional roller coaster unlike anything you have ever experienced. You will flip rapidly from a day in which you are euphorically convinced you're going to own the world to a day in which doom seems only weeks away and you feel completely ruined, and back over. And over, and over, and over. And that's something that you have to realize if you're an entrepreneur. It's going to be like this, but it's amazing. Once you start it, you're never going to want to change it anymore. I sometimes take this guy as a good example. You probably know him. And there's Davy Kessens, who did TwitSpark. And I took him because he on the angel.me, which is the platform that we're going to do for startups, we see a lot of projects coming in from two regions. One is from the Limburg, if I look in Flanders now, one is from Limburg region, and a lot of people are studying at the PHL. And second is from around Kortrijk, and a lot of people here studying at the whole West. And I took Dave here because he's a Limburg guy who studied, or at least part of the time over here. And I think that what Ho West and PHL are doing really well is giving the young people the envy to create. I don't know how they're doing it here, but they must be doing something really well. I take Davy here, but we also have the guy from Social Express here. They're doing amazing as well. So congratulations for what you're doing. So those are young people who are going for it. And this is something that we're launching now in the coming weeks. So as I told you, we did Sonic Angel for music. We launched Film Angel for film. We're doing Fashion Angel for fashion. And Angel.me is going to be the one for where we're going to combine crowdfunding for startups, where we're going to grant access to capital and other funds, and also going to do some support. How should you see it? Just taking a step back on crowdfunding, you have three models in crowdfunding. Just keep that in your head. You have one model where you donate, and it means that you kind of pre-sell your product. That's what we mostly do with music. You pre-buy an album, you pre-buy an experience, and you get some return for it. Another model is where you lend. You lend to other people, and there are some models around it. And a model that I absolutely love is called Kiva. It's a US-based company where you lend out to mainly starters in Africa and Latin America, and where they have small amounts of money to grow their businesses and then pay it back. And the third one, which is going to grow immensely because it used to be illegal, but it's going to be legal now, it's where you do crowdfunding for equity. So you're going to take a stake in the company. So you, as a startup, you raise your money and you give shares in your company. That's how it's going to work. As always, we're going to work not only to select the good or try to find the good startups and raise the capital for them. We're also, I believe a lot that if a startup in Belgium doesn't get international in its first 2 years of existence, it won't get out. And our country is too small for mainly technology-based countries. So what we're going to do is set up partnerships with a lot of countries where once your company exists 2-3 years and you have traction, but you have to go abroad, you have to restart because you don't have contacts and you don't have others. And there's a lot of really great, what I call incubators and accelerators. I've taken two from the West Coast because I know them fairly well. Y Combinator is a program where they invest a small amount of money, usually around $30,000 for 5 or 6%, but then they take you in-house and help you grow your company. 500 Startups is Dave McClure. It's a guy who says that in the in 4 years' time, he wants to invest in 500 companies because statistically he thinks that then he'll have so much success that he'll pay everything back. And he's now at 300. It goes so quickly, and he's investing all over the world. There's also an important breeding place to find ideas and go in it. It's the Y Combinator of 500 startups. The one that I think is doing an amazing job is in Brussels called Beta Group. Ramon is here somewhere, I think. Yeah. Talk to him because he can help you and they can connect you so much to other people. It's very often you have your ID, but other people can help you in achieving it. This is an interesting curve. For our crowdfunding for startups, we have one of the partners that we work with. So we're building an international network. It's called CrowdCube in the UK. This is their first one where they try to raise £1 million because that's the maximum in the UK. And it's done in, exactly 1 month. So they raised £1 million in a month with a company, which is fairly okay. This is an even more interesting example, I think. And do you know this Pebble story? Yeah. So Pebble Watch is kind of a connected watch where you can combine your applications, and it's a kind of a Wi-Fi or wireless watch. It's an amazing way. It's an amazing product. They actually needed $100,000 to be able to make the watch, and they went to a couple of investors, and they had no everywhere. Everybody said, we don't believe in your product, and we don't believe anybody's ever going to buy it. So they said, okay, we're going to do crowdfunding. We're going to go to the audience and we're going to try to prove them wrong. And the campaign ended 2 days ago. And they collected $10,266,000. This is the record. That's not always going to go like that. But it shows you how it's redefining how people are thinking and launching their product. Because we often talk about web startups, but this is a manufacturing with a very smart element in it. They had nearly 70,000 investors. So instead of having one investor giving them 100,000 and they all said no, now he has nearly 70,000 who gave them a million or 10 million. And that's the incredible potential. So that's kind of the base of my story. What's been happening in the creative industries in music and film is thanks to the law creating new models. It's creating an opportunity for whoever wants to be an entrepreneur. And if you don't want to be an entrepreneur, it's okay as well. But if you want to be and you have your dream of starting your company and taking it national or international, this is an incredible way, not only to find your complete budgets, but I'm pretty sure that in 1 year, banks will use crowdfunding as a funnel mechanism. And that means that they'll say, okay, we'll lend you 200,000, but on the condition that you can find 50,000 somewhere else. And VCs will tell, okay, we'll invest 200,000 if you can raise 75,000 somewhere else. And so it's gonna completely change the way that the venture capital industry will structure and function, and I think it's for the better, because at the end the power is going to be back to the audience. And I'm going to conclude with this, because of course this evening it's something I'm not even there, but this is our little Iris who is going to perform, and I really like your story. Eurovision is what it is, and some people like it and most people don't. But this was a 15-year-old girl who came onto a contest with us. She had so many votes out. She started a social media campaign herself. At one day I was in a Deleuze and I saw her post her vote Iris on Sonic Angels. She came out of it as first as a 15-year-old, set up the campaign as a 60-year-old. 16, she said, okay, I'm going to crowdfund an album. Or crowdfund a single, I think it was. The single did really well. They picked her up by Eurovision and by the VRT, and it was done a lot on Eminem and on Q Music. And in one of her first interviews, they asked her, what is your largest dream in life? And hers was to go to Eurovision one day. And so you see that by doing something that she believed in and by using the crowd as something you supported, at least she's creating her own dream. I hope it's going to continue until the end of the week. For angel.me, so we're launching, I think, in about a month. You can enroll and you can get involved in many ways. So you can be there to launch your own startup, but also if you want to be a mentor to other companies, and it can go as far as you want. I think that being involved with a startup is a little bit like your status on Facebook. Sometimes you're looking for something interesting and then you're very free, and sometimes you're doing some other stuff and then your schedule is busy, and it's going to move like that with a lot of people. You can indicate, okay, now I want to be part of an entrepreneurship, now I want to support them, now I want to help them, and now I want to be really left alone. And that's something that we're going to work on, and in that way connect a new kind of ecosystem of entrepreneurship and try to boost in that regard. Thank you.